This week, it's the turn of Azure Active Directory and the ultimate beginner's guide. Are you ready to learn? Let's go. Greetings, my fellow YouTubers. Welcome to the channel, especially if this is your first visit. I really do appreciate it. Okay, Andy Malone, Microsoft MVP, as well as a Microsoft Certified Trainer. Now, a couple of years ago, when I started my channel, one of the very first videos that I did was a session on getting started with Azure Active Directory. And I sat here realizing that, you know, an awful lot has happened in that 2 years in terms of how the product has evolved. So I thought I would take this session to take a look at the ultimate beginner's guide, if you will. So if you've just come into Azure Active Directory or you're thinking of a career in the cloud, then this hopefully will really help you put you in the right direction. All right. Now, in this episode, we're going to talk about the architecture. We're going to talk about creating users. We'll talk about groups and how they work. We'll talk about roles or role-based access control or RBAC, all designed to get you up and running as quickly as possible. Now, if you've not subscribed to the channel, we love subscribers. So hit that subscribe button, ring the bell, and you won't miss out on future tutorials. And if you enjoy the session, then please bump the like button. It really does make a difference to my channel. And if you've got questions, comments about this or any of my other sessions, then of course, please just get them down below. So I think without any further ado, let's go and have a quick look at the architecture of Azure Active Directory, and then we'll get into some cool demos. Let's have a look. So Azure Active Directory is Microsoft's cloud or identity as a service solution. And unlike that little server that's perhaps hosted in your own company, these servers are hosted in vast Microsoft data centers, which are distributed around the world. And these things are absolutely enormous, and they contain literally thousands and upon thousands of servers. And the idea is that we have a number of data centers in each region. So within each data center, of course, your Azure Active Directory is hosted here. And you can see it's hosted in the cloud. So the absolute core of it is all managed by Microsoft. So instead of you being able to manage the database, you only manage essentially your tenant. And within your tenant, you've got your users, your groups, your devices. Okay, so you don't need to worry about backing up or managing your tenant, because ultimately this is what you pay Microsoft for. Okay, of course, once a user gets authenticated, they can then access the vast number of resources that are out there in the cloud. Okay, which is very cool. Like Active Directory, of course, it's a database. Objects have attributes, first name, last name, email address, and so on. How is Azure Active Directory distributed then? Well, as I mentioned, Microsoft have multiple data centers around the world. For example, I work a lot in Norway, and in Norway we have two data centers. We have one in Oslo and the other one in Stavanger. So typically it works like this. One of the data centers will have the primary copy of the database. And so essentially this is a writable copy of the database. In the same data center, we also have an array which contains a read-only copy of the database, again, for redundancy purposes. You should also know that a copy of that same database is also replicated to a sister and also other data centers throughout the world. So the idea is that you've got ultimate redundancy if you just happen to have a failure. The database has a number of different layers, and the idea is it's to protect you against a potential failure. So now that we've discussed the architecture of Azure Active Directory, it's time to dive in and look at the various components. So if you're ready, let's buckle up. So to create a user account, I'm going to come in here into Azure Active Directory, into the portal. Now, to be honest, it doesn't matter really which portal you do it in. So if you're an avid Microsoft 365 user, again, we can go into users and active users, and you can create the same users here because, in fact, it's the same Azure Active Directory. There is no difference. The only difference is, by the way, there isn't one portal to rule them all. So unfortunately, there are only certain things that you can do in one portal and other things you have to do in another. Unfortunately, that's just the way it is. I'm going to come down here into users. And the first thing I'm going to do, of course, I'm going to create a new user. And you've got a choice. Do you want to create a new user or a new external user or guest user? If you want to know more about this, then please check out my recent video and I'll put a link in the description below. So for now, I'm going to create a new user. So I'm going to come into the portal. I'm going to scroll down and it asks me for a username. So I'm a big Game of Thrones fan. So I'm going to create a new user called Jon Snow. So here we go. Jon Snow. I'm going to type in Jon and Snow. Now, do I want to auto-generate the password, or am I happy for Azure to go ahead and create one for me? I'm happy with that at the moment. Do I want to add John into some groups? I'll come back to that in a moment. I don't want him to be any kind of administrator, so I'm just going to make him a member of the user role, which is just regular users. Now, if you're not ready for John to sign in yet, so if you're provisioning his account and he's not joining the company, it's a good idea to block the sign in. All right. The other thing that you can also do is you can also create a usage location. And essentially what this does is it places the user's data in their country. So, for example, this tenant is in the United States. So for legal and compliance reasons, it will ensure that my data remains within the United States. But you can change that, by the way. There are ways to change that. I can put some information here. I can put company name, department. So, for example, if I said, hey, you know, he's in sales, I can even assign a manager to John if I want to. I'm happy, so I'm going to click on create, and off it goes. And it now creates John. I'll just do a quick refresh on that. And if I scroll down, you will see that in fact, I have, sometimes it just takes a second or two just to come in. Let's try again. And indeed, there we see. We can now see that we have a user called Jon Snow. So when we go into John's account, this is everything that we need to know about John's account. So for example, we have some logs here, so it shows us the last time he signed in and so on. We also have some, if he's got any admin roles, is he a member of a particular group, applications that have been assigned to him, what licenses, what devices, and so on. I can also go in and view John's properties by clicking on the Edit Properties button. And in here, you can see, in fact, this was actually just recently updated. We now have a lot more information in here. And I think the main reason for this is Azure AD is now classed as a multi-cloud solution. So if you're using HR systems, for example, then they're going to fully integrate with this. So I can go in here, you can see it shows me when John was created, the last time he changed his password, if it's an external user or not. You've got these free fields that you can fill in. His location, his address, his details. And you can see a lot of this could potentially come from a HR system. Now, you can scroll down through all of these fields, or you can use these tabs that will take you through to the various sections, which is kind of cool, actually. Okay. So there's his usage location. Like the other thing that we now have is we also have an on-premises tab. So if John had synced from on-premises, so if you were using Active Directory and Azure AD Connect, then you can sync your users from on-premises into the cloud. And this is kind of cool because it gives us a nice report of the status of John's account. So that's kind of cool. Now, of course, as I mentioned, one of the things you might want to do is assign a license. And this is not the only place where you can do that. I can simply go into active users in Microsoft 365, for example. And if I do a quick refresh here and scroll down, sure enough, hopefully you'll see that John's account is here. So if I just scroll down, and there he is. So I can now click into John's account. And one of the first things you're going to want to do is you're going to want to assign a license to him. So all those attributes from Azure Active Directory are here. It's because it's the same directory service. Now, one of the things that is different here is that you've got things like OneDrive and Mail. Of course, you won't get that in Microsoft Azure. So one of the things I'm going to want to do is I'm going to want to assign a license to this user. So I'm assigning an E5 plus mobility and security, and I'm also going to grant John a license for Windows 11. Now, you can also see in here that because it's a Microsoft 365 license, he also has access to all of these different apps. And this is cool because if you didn't want him to, let's say, use Microsoft Bookings, you can just take that checkbox out and he doesn't have it. And I'm going to go ahead, I'll save my changes, and now John Snow is a fully licensed Microsoft 365 user. And you can go in, you can change that anytime that you want. Isn't that cool? Okay, so that is how you create a user and manage them in Microsoft 365. There is one last thing that we need to talk about though. So what I want to do here is I want to select a user. And what happens if John leaves the company? Well, if John leaves the company, of course, you're going to need to delete him. So when you delete a user account in Microsoft 365 and or Azure Active Directory, there's no content here in the things like OneDrive and email. So normally, in fact, that's probably not a good example. So let me select another user. I've got a user here called, let's say Lydia. Let's see if we've got a user, Joanna. Okay, so here's Joanna, and I want to delete a user. Now, because Joanna is a mature user in our company, she's got lots of files and things like that. So here it's like, what do you want to do with those files? So for example, she can delegate access to her mailbox to another user. You can grant user an access to OneDrive. So it could be a manager or somebody like that, and they can back up her copies of her files. Likewise, you can give access to her mailbox to another user as well. So you can give them full access. Now, I did a session on this recently. So again, I'll put the link in below and check it out. All right. So when you're happy to delete that user, you simply just go ahead, delete that user, and you can do this, as I say, either from the Azure portal or the 365 portal. And that will go, and everything that Joanna was and is has now been deleted. And what happens to that data is, first of all, the licenses are recouped. And that data then comes into the deleted users container here. Now, the nice thing is if you realize, oh my goodness, I just made a mistake, I can scroll down, I can select Joanna, and of course, I can restore that user back. But you need to do this within 30 days. Okay, so there we have it. In Azure Active Directory, and also in Microsoft 365, creating, managing, and deleting a user. So now we've created a user account, I suppose the next thing we should talk about are groups. And groups can be found here in Azure Active Directory. Now in here, if you go ahead and create a new group, there are essentially two types of groups that you can create here. You can create a security group, and you can also create a Microsoft 365 group. Now, in addition, you can also create groups from in the portal here. So I can scroll up, but I can just collapse that down, just expand the menu, and you can see here we've got Teams and Groups. Again, I can go into Active Teams and Groups. By the way, in here, you'll notice that we have got four types of groups. So these two, of course, are specific to Microsoft Exchange Online, which you don't get that in the Azure portal. So in essence, what we have is a security group, which again is the same security group here. So security groups are really useful, but they don't have any collaboration capabilities. So you can't make appointments with them. They're just purely for permissions. Now, the one thing that's nice about security groups, and in fact, I'll go ahead and create a group here. So I'm going to call this, you know, I'm in the US. So let's say I'll call this is my NYC. I'm going to call this my NYC, let's say, sales. Okay, so I'm going to call this my NYC sales team. I can put in a description here. One of the things that you can do in Azure is that you can give them an admin role, and I'm going to come back to that a little bit later. Now, when you assign a membership, you've got the choice. Do you want it to be an assigned member, or which means basically you can just add in the users as and when you require, or you can use something pretty cool called dynamic users. And notice with security groups, you can also have devices in here as well. Now, if I change the group type to Microsoft 365 groups, again, you can see that this time though, you only get dynamic users as opposed to assigned users. So if I just choose assigned for now, one of the things that we can do here is I can then say, okay, do you want to assign an owner to the group? And the owners are really useful. It's almost like a manager, and they can manage the users and the members, and they can also invite guests if your company allows it. So for the purpose of this demo, my user account is the mod administrator. I'm just going to assign myself as a member. Now, like I said, I can just go in and assign members here. And for the purpose of this demo, I'm going to do that. But if you want to see dynamic users, then check out my dynamic users video that I recorded a little while back. Okay, it's on YouTube. So I'm going to go into members here. I'm going to go in, I'm going to add in Adele, Alex, I'm going to bring in Alan, and just let's click on select. So I've added my three members in, and I'm going to go off now, and I'm going to click create. And a Microsoft 365 group, when you create it here in the Azure Admin Center, it really doesn't do that much, but I'll show you what's contained within it. But I also want to show you a couple of very important things here. So I can go into the general tab for the groups. And this is where you've got various security settings. So for example, who can create Microsoft 365 groups? You might not want users creating these, but you can also add clever things like expiry dates on groups. So for example, I could add in, let's say I've just created this group called NYC, and I could add in NYC sales. And I could say, okay, I want to say in 6 months, if nobody is using that group, then I want to delete it. Okay, so AI and machine learning will constantly monitor this group now. And if there's no traffic in the group, it will delete it. And this can be really useful protecting your organization from things like group bloat, as we call it. So too many groups. Now, and you might ask me, well, Andy, what if a user is using it and I don't want to lose my data? Again, don't worry about that, because the AI will determine, no, the group's still in use, and it resets it for another 6 months. So it's a really, really nice, useful feature. Now, just to mention, when you create your groups, you can also, for example, here, you can set up a group naming policy. So you can have a suffix, a prefix, and a suffix. So, for example, NYC sales, NYC marketing, or it can be a suffix, marketing, NYC. You get the idea? So that, just a quick tip, that's really, really useful. Now, just before I leave this, let's flip over to Microsoft 365 and let's talk about the groups here. So, first of all, what does that group look like? So if I just refresh my page here, and if I scroll down, and we will see, in fact, that I've got this group called NYC Sales, and you can see that it's assigned. It's a private group. So what does that mean? So if I go into the properties of this group, and if I go into the settings, you'll notice that we have a private and a public group. Now, because this is a Microsoft 365 group, what this means is in Outlook, Microsoft 365 groups basically give you access to a shared mailbox. You get a shared SharePoint document library, you get a OneNote notebook, a Microsoft Planner, a Microsoft SharePoint Teams site, and much more. Now, the question is, do you want it to be private or do you want it to be public? So private means that only the members of the group can actually view it, whereas if it's public, it's discoverable by anyone, all right? Now, again, if you want people to be able to contact the group externally, we need to click this little checkbox on here. So I'm just going to go ahead, I'm going to click on save, and let's just have a quick look at what that Microsoft 365 group actually looks like. So to do that, I'm just going to flip over here and I'm going to open up Microsoft Outlook. And this is such a cool feature, by the way. So I can come into Outlook here, and if I scroll down, you can see it says Discover Groups. So if I click on to here and type in NYC and just enter that, there it is. Now I can request to join the group. And also, if it's a complete public group, it is a public group, but I think the timing, because I'm doing this demo quite quick, it hasn't come through. Sometimes the portals are a little bit slow, but I'm going to say, yep, I can. If it's a private group, I can say, message the group owner, I would like to join the group, please. All right, so that's quite useful. Whereas if it's a public group, basically what you'll get is I will say, okay, discover, and let's say if I just type in sales and enter that, you can see I can just join the group. So straight away, I can now join this group, and I've now got access to that group. So if I close that down, you can now see that I've got US sales here. And as I mentioned, you get a shared mailbox. You also get a shared document library for all your files. And so you can collaborate. And of course, you get the calendar, you get notebook, planner, site, and so on. And one of the super smart things about Microsoft 365 groups, and check this out, is if I scroll down here in Microsoft 365, I can now extend this group to become a Microsoft team. And that adds all the chat and the communication capabilities. And also, you can talk to third-party applications as well. Now, this is an irreversible action, of course. So once you switch this on, you can't then switch it off. So there you have it. Groups in Azure Active Directory and Microsoft 365. So the third and final part of my guide to Azure Active Directory has to be roles and administrators. Now, of course, roles and admins, what does that actually mean? This is sometimes referred to as RBAC or role-based access control. And the idea of role-based access control, and you can do this from both Azure Active Directory, of course, and you can also do this from Microsoft 365. The idea of this is we can see that we have a number of different types of roles. So for example, Azure Active Directory here, Microsoft Exchange, Intune, and so on. And the idea of the various roles is that you don't want to give a user global admin rights. Now, typically, within any organization, you should have no more than 5 global admins and maybe no less than 2. So what are you going to do for the other administrators in your company? So what we have here, and it's really easy to get kind of overwhelmed by this, but we have tons and tons of different types of roles. Now, initially, this looks really overwhelming. And what you can see, though, is if you look closer, you'll notice that they're actually grouped. Okay, so for example, in Microsoft Exchange, we have an Exchange admin and you also have an Exchange recipient role. And you can see these are the specific permissions that that role can actually do. And you also have other roles, so things like Teams, SharePoint, and so on. Now, what you can do, of course, is I can scroll down here, and the second most powerful role that we have is a user admin. So if you don't want a senior administrator in your organization, you don't want him to have all the power, what you can do is you can grant him the rights to the user admin role. And if I click into the role itself, you can see I can go into the description of the role here, and it tells me a little bit about the role, and pretty much he can do an awful lot, this guy. So basically, he can manage all aspects of users and group creation, management, and also licensing for those users. So I can then go into assignments and I'll say, hey, that sounds great. I want to add an assignment for this user. So now just mention one thing, by the way, this screen here that I'm actually in, this is actually a feature in Azure Active Directory called PIM, or Privileged Identity Management. Okay, what does that mean, Andy? Well, if I go back into Microsoft 365, and let's say I come into, let's say what we got here. Let's choose one. Let's say we have a user here and I want him to be a security admin. Okay, so I'm going to go into assignments here and I'm going to add a user. So in here, I'm going to say, okay, I've got a user here called Alan, and I would like Alan to be a security administrator. So the problem with that, though, is A, it's for the entire organization, okay? So if I close that down now, I'm just going to close that down, and if I come back and let's look at the same role in Azure Active Directory. So I just want to show you a couple of little interesting things here. So very important. So if I just scroll down here and if I come into, let's say, the security administrator role, and in here you can see there he is. Here is Alan and he's a user. He's got access to the entire directory. It's been directly assigned to him. But check it out. Look, it's a permanent. So Alan is a permanent administrator. Now, you might not want that. You might want the user to only have, let's say, a temporary assignment. So what we mean by PIM, or Privileged Identity Management, is this. So if I scroll down here and then, let's say, go into the user admin role, let me do that same demo again, but this time I'm going to add an assignment here. Now, you'll notice here that some of the options are kind of grayed out. And in fact, you can see that you've got settings here. So one of the things you might want to do in advance is you might want to go either into the settings or the role settings. It's the same thing. And you can click on edit. And what this does is it allows for temporary access. So, for example, if Alan's going on vacation and you need to take over Alan's job, what I'm going to do is I'm going to grant you 12 hours of access, let's say. Do I require multi-factor authentication? That means if you're using the Microsoft Authenticator app on your phone, okay. Do you need to put in a reason why you're activating? I think that's a good idea. Does it require any kind of approval? No, I'm okay with it. And again, I can specify how long you're going to get access for. So you, it might just be a couple of weeks, might be a month, and so on. Okay, so for this demo, I'm just going to say a month. But you can change it if you want to. And I'll say, okay, when a user activates the role, do you want me to send a notification, an email? Okay, fair enough. You can choose who you want to send that email to. So I can now update those settings. And that, what that means now is that when I add an assignment, it will now pick up those settings. So I'm going to go in, I'm going to assign a user. And for this demo, I'm going to assign, I'll bring in Alex. Okay, now, if I do nothing and just click next, what I want to do is I want to make Alex active. And that's pretty much, I can put in a justification. Okay, so for his job. Okay, so you can see that Alex has now been assigned, and you can see specifically that he's permanently assigned. So what is this eligible option? This is something that admins really will use, by the way. So I'm going to click on assign. I'm going to maybe assign somebody else. And let's bring in Adele. So Adele is Alex's assistant. And I'm going to select. But this time, when I click next, I'm not going to choose active. I'm going to choose eligible. So if Alex goes on vacation, Adele is going to be able to take on his role for the for this duration, okay? So beyond this duration, when Alex comes back, she then loses that right, okay? So I'm now going to assign that, and now you can see that Adele doesn't appear. But if I go into eligible assignments, sure enough, she's here. So here is Adele, and if I just scroll over, you can see that that date has come in here. So there we go. That's really cool. So this is called privileged identity management. And the idea of this is that it provides something called just-in-time access, and they're just getting enough administration. So users don't need to have full global admin permissions. And that's the purpose of RBAC. Role-based access control. In other words, just give them what they need, not necessarily everything, okay? A really cool feature. So there you have it, the Azure Active Directory Ultimate Beginner's Guide. I really hope that you enjoyed it and that you got a lot out of it. Remember, if you did, bump that like button. It really does make a difference. And if you've not subscribed, then go ahead, hit the subscribe button, ring the bell, and you won't miss out on future tutorials. All right, and as always, I love your comments, your questions, and your feedback. So please get those down below. And that's it for this week. Okay, thanks very much for joining me, and I really appreciate it. And we'll see you next time around. Hey, thanks so much for dropping by today. Here's a couple of videos that you may enjoy. And while you're here, go ahead, click on the subscribe button, and you won't miss out.